Today we're going to learn how to use 30 lines of Python code to build this, a gyro balancing Segway robot. So don't go anywhere. G'day, I'm Mr. Code, and I can't believe this is the 11th video in my Python for LEGO Mindstorms series. Thank you so much for your support, and from now on, I'll continue the series with the Mindstorms Robot Inventor. But you can still follow along if you use SPKE Prime, but by now you'll know that it is practically the same. Before you skip ahead to these timestamps, please give this video a thumbs up because I spend a lot of time on these videos and your support really means a lot to me. So thank you in advance. Let's start building. So PID controllers are designed just like any other controller. They take an input, and then from the available information, it will send an output signal to the actuators, or in our case, the motors, to fulfill a specific task. Imagine for a moment that we are programming for a self-driving car, and we want to have it stop at a stop sign. We can do this by changing its speed as a function of the distance it has yet to travel. At 50 meters away, the car perceives that it is not close enough to the stop sign. So it perceives that the current error is 50 meters. We can design our controller to change the speed of the car in kilometers an hour equal to the distance to the stop sign or error in meters. At 50 meters away, the car will set its speed to 50 kilometers an hour. And when it is 40 meters away, it sets the speed to 40 kilometers an hour. And when it's 25 meters away, it sets the speed to 25 kilometers an hour, and so on and so forth, until it comes to a gradual stop at the stop sign. This is called a proportional controller, where we link the speed of the car to the error of our current position. And it makes sense, right? When we are further away from the stop sign, we can travel quicker. And as we approach the target, we slow down. Pretty simple stuff. However, a proportional controller doesn't always work. Imagine if the stop sign was replaced by another car traveling in the same direction, moving at 20 kilometers an hour. And our program aims to follow that car by staying in a safe following distance. When our car is 50 meters away, we accelerate to 50 kilometers an hour. So far, so good. But there's a problem. Once we approach 20 meters from the target distance, we are traveling at 20 kilometers an hour, which is only just enough to stay with the car in front. But we have this constant error of 20 meters. And this is called a steady state error. And to fix this, we add an integrator. The integrator pathway keeps a running total of the error of the car. So as long as there is an error, then the integrator will take over the proportional path of the controller and increase our car speed faster than when we only had the proportional path. The combination of both the proportional path and the integrator path is called a PI controller. And that will help us solve our car's behavior when it's following a moving vehicle. And now we have the third problem. Depending on how our car reached the target zone behind the leading car, we may overshoot the destination, giving it a wobble effect. A big wobble in our case can risk colliding with the car in front. To solve this, we add a third path to our controller, the derivative. The derivative pathway eases the approach to the target, which means that it smoothens the wobble of the proportional and integral paths. And control engineers will tweak the weightings of each pathway to best fulfill their mission. These are known as gain values, KP, KI, and KD. And these basically multiply on top of the PI and D pathways. So now let's have a look at our code. The first part of the code is part of the boilerplate Mindstorms Python code that all files start with. This imports all of the libraries that Python needs in order to communicate with Mindstorms. Next, we define the hub and the motors necessary to refer back to them later on. Next is the most important part of your code, your PID gain values. These four lines should be all you'll need to adjust in order for your robot to balance. The KP value is how your robot recovers from a bad angle. If your robot doesn't seem to put enough power into the wheels, then this is the value that you would increase. And remember, you only need to increase these values until it is just right. If the values are too high, then the whole system's not going to work. The KI value is how your robot reacts to the speed of falling. So you want to increase this until your robot just overcompensates from falling. If your robot just falls flat without compensating or without trying to compensate, then you need to increase KI. But what you want is to see that your robot, as soon as it starts falling, is to recover but also overcompensate slightly. Okay. And finally, if both KI and KP are working, you need to have KD, and this is to reduce the wobble effect when your robot has recovered and overcompensated. So if that wobble effect is really big, then you will have to increase your KD value. And like I said, these are the values that I'm using at the moment. Feel free to tweak it yourself. You might need to change it for different surfaces as well. The roll target is your balancing angle. If you find that your robot is constantly drifting forward, then you need to lower this value by 0.01 degrees at a time until you are hovering around the middle. If you're constantly drifting back, then increase it by 0.01 degrees at a time. The next few variables are for your PID loop to use later. And these next lines here are to keep track of the robot's wheel rotations in order to keep the robot balancing in generally the same spot. And finally, this is the PID loop that brings everything together, calculating the resulting power that is being fed back into the wheels every few milliseconds to maintain the roll angle. If the angle exceeds a certain range, then the robot will stop its motors. Optionally, you can add some decoration to the hub light matrix. If you want to create a smiley face, for example, then you can add this code. Okay, so you just add this code just before the loop starts, if you wanted to make it have a smiley face. All right. And that's it, guys. Thank you so much for following and watching this video. If you want to ask me more, feel free to comment below and suggest any other questions that you might want me to answer. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.